Okay, good morning everyone, and welcome to JFD's weekly market outlook webinar for the week starting today and ending on February 14th. I'm Haralambos Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFD, and I will describe the most important economic releases and events on the financial agenda for the week ahead. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer first. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our webinar. Okay, then, last week market participants kept their gaze locked on developments surrounding the coronavirus, with China's policy steps providing some relief. However, the virus continues to spread at an exponential pace, and thus we expect investors to stay focused on headlines surrounding that front. So, the first item I have on the agenda is the Chinese coronavirus, and we will talk in a while in more detail about that. The next item is Fed Chair Powell's testimony before Congress. Then we have the RBNZ and Riksbank policy decisions on Wednesday, and on Thursday and Friday we get important US data, US CPIs, inflation data, and retail sales, both for January. So let's begin with Monday. Today would be a relatively light day in terms of economic releases. The only ones worth mentioning are Norway CPIs, which are already out and came in much better than expected. Then we have Canada's housing starts for January and the building permits for December. Although a light day in terms of economic data and releases, we don't expect market participants to relax and enjoy a relatively calm day. After all, the item on top of their lists is the coronavirus. So we believe that they will still be sitting on the edge of their seats in anticipation of news and headlines on that front. Although equities performed pretty well during most of the week, due to hopes that China's policy steps may contain the effects of the fast spreading virus, that was not the case on Friday, with the new virus killing more people than the SARS did globally in 2002 and 2003. Investors may have lost their faith in China's policies and are back in a risk-off mode, selling risky assets Friday and today during the Asian morning, and seeking shelter in safe havens like the yen. The yen was Friday's best performing currency. For the record, the death toll has surged to 910, so we have 910 deaths since January 23. You can see how exponential is the rate of the deaths, and also the confirmed cases, which hit 40,553. So, our own view is that if the virus continues spreading at a fast pace, we will. If the virus continues spreading at an exponential rate, incoming data may start revealing that the economic impact is larger and may last for longer than initially believed. Many believe that the Chinese economy will be well impacted during the first quarter of the year during the spreading of the coronavirus, but with no concrete signs that the virus could be stopped soon, the economic wounds could well drag into the second quarter. So if new undertaken measures to prevent the spreading continue to prove insufficient. This week could be marked with defensive trading and investing, meaning lower equity prices, lower risk-linked currencies like the Aussie and the Kiwi, and higher safe havens like the Swiss franc and the yen. Now, moving to Tuesday, Japan's markets will be closed in celebration of the National Day. But from Australia, we get the NAB business survey for January, with the confidence index expected to have rebounded to zero from minus 0.2. Although the survey is not a major market mover, given the RBA's emphasis on the labor market, we will pay close attention to the labor costs index, which ticked up to 0.9% quarter over quarter in December from 0.8% in November. This is a 3-month rolling rate. So at its latest meeting, the RBA decided to keep interest rates unchanged, but the accompanying statement was once again less dovish than anticipated. Officials noted that the bushfires and the coronavirus outbreak will weigh on domestic growth temporarily. And even though they reiterated they remain prepared to ease further if needed, they highlighted again that the rates remained untouched due to the long and variable lags in the transmission of monetary policy. Nevertheless, with the coronavirus keep spreading at a fast pace, we don't believe that improving wages will vanish expectations with regards to further cuts by this bank, the RBA, especially given Australia's close trading relationship with China. This means that Australia may be one of the economies outside China that could be affected the most. According to the ASX 30-day interbank cash rate futures yield curve, which I have here, we can see that investors are currently anticipating another cut by the RBA to be delivered in August. Now the rate is at 0.75%, and you can see that the rate falls by 25 basis points and even slightly more in August. Now, during the European morning of Tuesday, after we get the NAB survey, we get a string of data releases from the UK, kicking off with the preliminary GDP for the fourth quarter. Expectations are for the quarter-over-quarter rate to have held steady at 0.4%, but this will drive the year-over-year rate down to 0.8% from 1.1%. You can see that the trend in UK GDP has been to the downside at least since 2015 from where we have data. So we may get another slowdown in the year-over-year rate. What's more, following the first increase after 5 quarters of declines, business investment is expected to have tumbled again in quarter four. So we had a small rebound in quarter three, but the fourth quarter is expected to reveal another tumble in business investment. Specifically, expectations are for a 1.3% slide following a 0.5% growth in the third quarter. Then both industrial and manufacturing productions, both the industrial and manufacturing production year-over-year rates are expected to have risen in December, but to have remained within the negative territory, while the nation's trade deficit for the same month is forecast to have widened. So, what does this mean in terms of Bank of England policy? When it last met, the Bank of England decided to hold rates unchanged, disappointing those who were expecting a rate cut to be delivered. Heading into the meeting, according to the CME MPC futures, there was a 45% chance for a 25 basis points rate decrease. That said, the statement had a dovish flavor, had a more dovish flavor than the previous one, with the committee dropping its gradual tightening wording, and adding that policy may need to be to reinforce the expected recovery in UK GDP growth should the more positive signals from recent indicators of global and domestic activity not be sustained, or should indicators of domestic prices remain relatively weak. Now, the probability for lower rates rises again above 40% at the June meeting. So having that in mind, softness in the data we described, the GDP, the industrial production, the manufacturing production, the trade balance and business investment, may push that percentage somewhat higher, which means the pound could come under some selling interest. However, our view is that policymakers will place more emphasis on data pointing to how the economy has been performing in the post-election era before deciding whether to cut or stay sidelined. After all, they clearly pointed that they wait for data to confirm the positive signals from recent indicators like the PMIs. And now inflation is taking the first place on their list. Now, later in the day, the spotlight will turn to Fed Chair Powell's testimony before Congress. He will testify before the House Financial Services Committee on Tuesday, while on Wednesday, he will present the same testimony before the Senate Banking Committee. The key message we got from the latest FOMC meeting was that policymakers are not comfortable with inflation persistently under their 2% target, and with the core PC rate staying below that objective since December 2019, expectations with regards to another rate cut by the Fed are still well entrenched, despite the improvement in January's PMIs and Friday's better than expected employment report for the month. So, according to the Fed Fund futures, investors are fully pricing in a 25 basis points reduction to be delivered in September, and you can see it from the yields of the Fed Fund futures I have here. The current rate is here, a 25 basis point cut is priced in for September. Thus, Powell may stick to his guns that there is little tolerance within the Fed to low inflation, while we expect him to acknowledge that the coronavirus constitutes a new risk to the economic outlook. So this means that the dollar may slide if indeed Powell sounds somewhat more concerned, as market participants may bring somewhat forth the timing of when they expect the Fed to cut again. However, bearing in mind that the US currency sometimes wears its safe haven suit, we would treat any potential slide as a corrective move if concerns surrounding the coronavirus intensify during this week. In such a case, we prefer to exploit any potential upcoming dollar strength against risk-linked currencies like the Aussie and Kiwi, which tend to slide during periods of market turbulence. The slide in the dollar may continue only if investors decide to ignore again the fast spreading virus and start increasing their risk exposures. Now, moving to Wednesday, during the early Asian morning, we have the first central bank meeting scheduled for this week. It's the RBNZ decision. This will be one of the bigger meetings where, apart from the decision, the statement and the minutes, we also get the quarterly monetary policy statement, which includes updated economic projections, as well as a press conference by Governor Andrea Orr. At its November meeting, the RBNZ surprised investors who were largely pricing in a rate cut and instead decided to stand pat, keeping rates at 1%. That said, they maintained their easing bias, saying that they will add further monetary policy stimulus if needed. They also noted that employment remains around its maximum sustainable level. Now, since then, New Zealand's CPI accelerated to 1.9% from 1.5%, just a tick below the midpoint of the bank's target range of 1 to 3%, while the unemployment rate ticked down to 4% from a downwardly revised 4.1%. However, given that the employment change revealed no new added jobs, the decline in the unemployment rate may have not been for the good reasons. Indeed, with the participation rate sliding to 70.10% from 70.40%, the slide in the unemployment rate may be owed to many people being discouraged to register as unemployed and seek for a job. In any case, our humble view is that the employment report was not that disappointing, and combined with the notable rise in the nation's inflation rate above the bank's latest projection for the quarter, which was at 1.6%, all this may allow policymakers to wait for a while more before they decide to cut. This may result in a higher QE, as some of those who were anticipating a rate cut in November may have pushed their bets into this meeting. Having said all that, the big risk to our view is the fast spreading coronavirus, which could have a negative impact on New Zealand's economy. Let's not forget that New Zealand is one of China's main trading partners. Now, later during the European morning, the central bank torch will be passed to the Riksbank. At its last meeting for 2019, the world's oldest central bank has decided to hike rates by 25 basis points to 0%, becoming the first bank to abandon the negative rate regime after adopting it back in 2015. Officials also noted that the rate is expected to stay at 0% in the coming years, but added that if the economic outlook and inflation prospects were to change, monetary policy may need to be adjusted. Both the CPI and CPIF rates for December held steady at 1.8 and 1.7% respectively, while the core CPIF rate, which excludes energy, has ticked down to 1.7% from 1.8%. In our view, this suggests that we are unlikely to get any major changes from the Riksbank, neither in policy, neither in the bank's language. Thus, this may be one of the quiet meetings of this bank in terms of reaction in the Swedish krona. Now, as for the rest of Wednesday's events, as we already noted, Fed Chair Powell will present his testimony before the Senate Banking Committee, while the only noteworthy indicator on the agenda is Eurozone's industrial production for December. Here, the forecast is for a slide, for a 1.5% slide after a 0.2% increase in November. Now, moving to Thursday. The main event on the agenda is the US CPIs for January. Headline rate is forecast to have risen further above the Fed's target of 2%. Specifically, it's expected to have ticked up to 2.3% year over year from 2.2% in December. The core CPI rate is forecast to have ticked down to 2.2% from 2.3%. Having said all that, though, the year over year rate of the change in WTI crude oil has dropped into negative territory during the month. Remember that the difference between the headline CPI and the core CPI is based on the volatile items of food and energy. So here on this graph we have the difference between the headline and the core CPI rates. The gray area here is the difference, is the spread of those CPIs, which tends to be pretty correlated with the year-over-year change in WTI. So that oil prices play a significant role in the divergence between the headline and the core CPI rates. So as I said, that year-over-year rate of the WTI change has dropped into negative territory during the month. So if indeed the core CPI slows, logically we see the risks of the headline CPI to slow more, to come below the core CPI. So if indeed this is the case, a slowdown in the CPI inflation metrics may raise speculation that the year-over-year core PCE rate, which is the Fed's favorite inflation gauge, may slide further below the Fed's objective of 2%. Remember that the rate stood at 1.6% in December and has been below the 2% target since December 2018. So, conditional upon Powell reiterating that the Fed is not comfortable with inflation persistently under 2%, speculation of further slowdown in the PCE rate may prompt investors to add to bets with regards to another cut by the Fed, and this could thereby extend the dollar's potential correction. Now, let's move to Friday. During the European morning, we get the second estimate of Eurozone's GDP for the fourth quarter, but as it is usually the case, it is expected to confirm its first estimate. Namely, it is anticipated to confirm that the euro area economy slowed to 0.1% from 0.2% in quarter three. Later, from the US, we have the retail sales for January. Headline sales are expected to have grown 0.3%, the same pace as in December, while core sales are forecast to have slowed to 0.3% from 0.7% the month before. What's more, both industrial and manufacturing productions are expected to have slid 0.2% month over month. So, another round of soft US data will add more credence to the idea that investors could bring forth the timing of when they expect another rate cut by the Fed. Remember, we said earlier that another rate cut is anticipated for September. So with what we saw here, what we described here, the CPI, the Powell's testimony, and retail sales data, we may see investors bringing that timing closer, maybe in August, maybe in July. And all these support that the greenback, which has been in a strong uptrend lately, could come under a selling pressure and thereby trigger a correction. But I repeat, given that the dollar usually acts as a safe haven, we cannot talk about a trend reversal. We could get a correction, but if concerns surrounding the coronavirus intensified, the dollar could resume its uptrend soon. Another data point on the agenda of Friday is the preliminary University of Michigan Consumer Sentiment Index for February, which is forecast to decline somewhat to 99.3 from 99.8. However, this is usually not a major market mover. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. I hope you have a great week, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again next Monday. If you are interested in more detailed and frequent analysis, you can find me on our YouTube channel from Tuesday to Friday at around 8:30 a.m. GMT time. So I wish you luck. I wish you having a good week of trading. So from me, goodbye.